Welcome. This is a special meeting of the Scarborough Board of Education. Mrs. Sato, may I have your attendance?
Mrs. Dooley?
Here.
Mrs. Piazza?
Here.
Mrs. Lane?
Here.
Mrs. Massengill?
Here.
Mrs. Murphy?
Here.
Mrs. Perry?
Here.
Mrs. Shea?
Here.
Mrs. Murray? Ms. Hartle?
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are there any adjustments to the agenda, Dr. Anderson?
There is. To substitute for 7.0 adjournment, there is 7.0, which will allow for board deliberation, and then 8.0 will be adjourned.
Thank you. Well, we are now going to enter into a public session with regards to the calendar of the school year 2015-16. So, this is an opportunity for us to figure out together the best way to provide our district with the chance to do the work that must be done to move our schools forward. If anyone from the public wishes to speak with regards to the calendar, you'll be able to come to the microphone in just a few minutes. Please state your name and your address, and also if you've mentioned what schools your children attend or your child. You'll notice at the podium that there's some sheets there for you to put your name printed and your address. Street only, we don't mean that you're in Scarborough, you know that. The board has already heard from parents, from some of our parents, so please do not repeat comments made by others ahead of you, but rather present new information or suggestions. The board is likely to respond to questions, particularly if we wish to clarify information or misinformation. If there are any questions that cannot be answered this evening, they will be recorded, and answers will be provided as soon as possible on the school webpage. The board will not be making any decisions this evening. We will have a second reading on the calendar next Thursday night at Town Hall at 7 o'clock, when the vote will be taken. Dr. Entwistle is now going to walk you through the packets that you have taken from the table. If you haven't done so, please do so now. Dr. Entwistle?
Good evening. You have a couple of handouts here. One that has blue printing on it is frequently asked questions, and I will review what's in that in just a moment. As well, you should have a copy of the draft number one, which was the presentation from the Leadership Council to the school board. The Leadership Council is gathered pretty much up in this area. It consists of all of the principals, assistant principals, and department heads in the school. Sorry. Are you able to hear me so far?
Thank you.
Okay. So draft number one is the original proposal submitted to the board by the Leadership Council. Draft two was an alternative that was developed that would reflect early release time in the same quantity as what you find in terms of late start time on proposal number one. So they essentially mirror the same amount of time. Draft number one, the proposal of the Leadership Council involves late starts. Draft number two is an alternative to look at what an early release schedule would look like that would accommodate our teachers and our leaders with the same amount of time. Also, in terms of calendars, you will find that there is a new proposal number two, which is K-2 only. New proposal number two consists of, K-8 only, New proposal number 2K8 consists of 23 late starts. New proposal number 3, also K8 only, consists of a reduced number of late starts, a total of 18, so it would be a difference of 8 from what we have this current year. And then there is one proposal for the high school. It is called New Proposal 2 and 3, High School Only, and it accommodates for the high school a late start on every Wednesday. There's a total of 32 of those, and so it's an increase for the high school only of 22 late starts. So those are the materials that we have. The calendars can get a little confusing. But let me just direct your attention to the frequently asked questions. I don't intend to read these to you. I don't know if my voice would hold up. I've been doing a lot of talking these last few days. But I will tell you what's here. Question number 1 asks, what shifts are happening in teaching and learning that require us to rethink the work that we're doing here in Scarborough? And basically, there are some fundamental and transformational changes that are happening not only in Scarborough, but across the nation in terms of the expectations that we have for students. And I think that you see in a block below that how that translates to the work that needs to be done by curriculum leaders. And when I say that, that's not just our director of curriculum, that's all of the leaders in our buildings, in our schools, and the impact in terms of teaching. Number 2 asks, what has happened in Scarborough as it relates to teacher learning time? And the short answer is, it went away when there were budget hard times, as did staff members that were lost. And I encourage you to read these. Number 3, why is this additional time needed? And essentially, it's needed in order for us to move Scarborough and keep our kids consistent with what's happening across the nation, because those are the kids that they are competing with. And the focus is for students, and the focus is for getting students ready for college, career, and for civic engagement. And again, there's some fundamental shifts and changes that are happening, and I encourage you to look at those under number 3. Number 4, so what is all this time and what's this time going to be used for? And the first block that you see really talks about the requirements that we have to do some transforming of the work and the way that you approach education in Scarborough. It involves all content areas and it involves all grades. And the focus of this work is no longer independent or isolated work for teachers, but collaborative work, teachers working together. What does this time not include? Well, basically, there's a whole list of things that this time is not intended to accommodate for. Things like creating papers, and creating bulletin boards, and preparing for meetings, and staff wellness. And the last bullet, it says, anything that does not advance the quality of teaching and learning. So essentially, all of those things that you see there are things that already happen, that teachers spend their own time to get done. This is not to build in time for these kinds of activities into the professional learning time. And again, I would direct your attention to the top box, which tells what the time is going to be used for. Question 5 says, why can't more teacher days be added to the calendar? In order to add additional staff days, it has a budget implication. The budget implication is that for every staff day that would be added, it would cost the town, cost the schools, better than $115,000 per day. At one point in time, there were upwards of 7 or more days and multiple early releases, I think, years ago. And those really went the way of tight budgets. We are now down to 3 staff days. Why does it have to be during the school? Well, I don't think that if we had an opportunity to expand the school day, there again, that would have budget implications and labor implications. But I guess the bottom line is, you're believing that the time that we are carving out of instructional time is more than going to pay back in terms of instructional quality. So it's really a focus on quality and not quantity. Why do students need to lose instructional time to meet this need? And perhaps I've addressed that. And is this model unique to Scarborough, or do other schools do this? Many other schools do this, and many schools that have not been doing it will be doing it next year. There are a number of schools that are moving in this direction. I think a metric to give to you is that the average teacher learning time, and we looked at every single school district across Cumberland and York County, the average time that's built into the school year for teachers, on average, 59 hours. Currently, in Scarborough, we're at 34 hours. What are the cost benefits of this model? I don't know if it's necessarily cost benefit or just not really having any other choice at this time, given the fact that we have just a barely adequate level of staff in our schools, and that we're not anytime soon going to try to be using the money that we may receive in the budget to be adding staff days. So we're really looking at the fact that the cost benefits here is that there is no impact on the school, on the school budget. There's no impact on the tax rate. It allows us to basically carve out minimal instructional time and trade that in for some high quality learning time so that the learning time that we do have on task is of higher quality in every single classroom. And then finally, number 10, why is it a late start instead of an early release? And there's a few points that basically speaks to the benefits and the challenges of both of those models. We have longstanding educators, principals, and leaders in the schools who have had experience here at Scarborough with early releases. And we have had experience these last few years with late starts. And we've tried to articulate in an objective way what we believe to be the benefit of both. And I can tell you that the unanimous opinion of the professionals that run these schools, including myself, is that late start is a preferred model, much more effective, much more beneficial model for our students. It also works better for everyone else. We recognize, and I recognize, that in making a change like this, the folks that are impacted are parents and kids. There's a level of disruption that comes with multiple late starts or multiple early releases, whichever model you do. And it's really the parents who take the brunt of that. We get that. It's a hassle. It's childcare issues. It's getting to work on time and all this other business. So we know that there can also be financial issues. But we also know that resources are limited. And when we look at who is going to benefit most from this, it is the students and the parents who will benefit from this model. I believe that that sort of covers what's in this package here. And so I'll put that to you.
And just to piggyback on that a bit, if you didn't have a chance to hear any of the board meeting that was held last Thursday night on transforming teaching and learning, please go on the town website. You can pull up the videos because they're all placed on there, dated by month. It'd be really worth it to take a look at that because of the lengthy explanation about what is about to happen over the state of Maine and throughout the country, really. So with that, we're going to allow people to come up to the mic again, address your comments to the chair, and we'll respond if we wish to. So if you live in Scarborough and you wish to come up to the mic, please go right ahead and do so. State your name and your address, and what school your students go to, your children go to, and if you could also at the end sign that piece of paper.
Hello, my name is Michelle Markham. I live on Scarborough Ridge Road, and I have a child in eighth grade at the middle school. First, I'd like to thank you for your community service to the town of Scarborough. I'm sure it's a big commitment to serve on the school board. I would like to address the calendar issues. Although I am in support of professional development for the teachers, I personally am not in support of late starts on Wednesday. My preference would be if I was given a choice between a late start or an early release, I would prefer a Friday early release over a Wednesday early release. I do not support late starts in any scheduled format, primarily for the following reasons. In addition to my child having less hours in the classroom, it does not allow my child to make good use of time. It is disruptive to her, and it is unproductive use of time. She cannot save her homework for the next morning to do in the morning before school, because it would be difficult to anticipate if there would be adequate time to complete. The public library and the high school libraries are both closed, and her sleep schedule would be disrupted if she were to waste the time by sleeping in. My daughter was here a year ago and presented to you a petition that she passed around that was signed by 530 people against late starts. I would prefer an early release. My child can work on homework. The public library and the high school libraries are open. There are options to do other after-school activities or meet with classmates. It's basically a more productive use of her time. I would like to remind you of the first item on the school board's operating protocol as posted on the Scarborough Public Schools website. The operating protocol states that the members of the Scarborough School Board hereby publicly commit ourselves collectively and individually to the following operating protocol. The children's interests come first. The board will represent the needs and interests of every child in our district. We will stay flexible, endeavor to meet the needs of every student, advocate for adequate and appropriate resources, and remain willing to examine how we might do our job better. I ask that you please keep that commitment to the children's interest in mind when you finalize the school calendar. I've complained about the late starts on the school calendar several times now over the years. I understand it would benefit the children to have the teachers increase their professional development, but there are many items which would negatively impact the children. I feel it is your duty to take into consideration all aspects of how the children are going to be impacted by so many early releases or late starts. I sincerely hope that you take into consideration the issues parents are raising and what is the best interest of the majority of the children of Scarborough. Thank you for listening, and thank you again for your dedication in your service.
Okay, thank you. And if anyone else is going to speak, would you just go right up and go ahead and line up so that we can reduce the amount of time in between? So just, you know, go ahead right up and then line up and then go in there.
There is some information about the late starts at the high school. There's information about the late starts at the high school that I think would be interesting to know, that it wouldn't be just, since it's every week. Do you want to explain how you're going to say? The library will be open at this point.
Basically, if the high school only proposal is adopted by the board, it would allow for a late start on every Wednesday. And there's a reason to differentiate the high school from the rest of the schools very quickly, mostly because we are working with a very archaic calendar that has been in, the school schedule that has been in place since the 80s or probably before. It's a very tight school schedule. It does not allow any real collaborative time at all in the high school for the teachers. We're hoping that the high school will move to a one-to-one so that we have technology capacity-wise, that we have one-to-one capacity all the way through our schools from 3 through 12. That alone is going to require a good bit of professional development time for our teachers. And the third piece is that the high school, unlike any of the other schools, goes through an accreditation process. It's the New England school accreditation process. It's a very lengthy process. It lasts over multiple years. And it's a highly prescriptive process that requires the faculty to engage collaboratively in sort of way beyond the level that would typically be expected. So that's the reason why the high school schedule is differentiated. In terms of how that would work for students, students who have transportation to high school would come late on Wednesdays. Students who rely on the bus would ride the regular ride, the regular route at the regular time, so it wouldn't be any different for them on Wednesday, but there would be safe and supervised spaces for them to work, and one of those spaces I think that you were getting to would be the library. So they would have access to workspace, they would have access to quiet space, they would have access to collaborative space if they're working on a project. I think that answers your question.
Yes. Okay. Hi, Kim Gambardella. Do you need my address? 6 Howard Lane. I have 3 kids in the school system, 8 Corners, Wentworth, and the middle school. First, I just want to thank the school board for having this public forum to allow the community to share their thoughts about the proposed school calendars. I understand you're trying to work hard for everyone's best interests, the kids, the parents, the teachers, and that's challenging. I also understand that we do need to increase the professional development time, but I have concerns about the proposals on the table. First, with Late Start is a huge challenge. Working parents have to find and pay for childcare options. There's limited childcare options because older siblings have already gone to school. There's no high school babysitters around. Buses are a disaster. In the 1.5 years that we've had late starts, they're rarely on time. Based on my own 3 kids and 3 buses and late pickup times, I've calculated on average, I think kids in our town are missing probably 20 to 30 minutes of additional instruction due to busing and transportation issues with late start. And as much as my middle schooler loves to sleep on late start mornings, my family morning routine is completely disrupted. I think it starts at home and the lack of routine continues through the beginning of middle school for him. Early release is a better option, although it's not perfect. It eliminates the late morning buses. You actually have high school or older siblings who are available to babysit, so it allows more options and possibly lower cost options for families. And kids can be productive in the afternoon. They have more playtime, after-school activities, the opportunity to do a class that they maybe have wanted to try. I think in both cases, going from 10 days of late starts to the initial proposal of 28 or 32 is extreme. It's a 215 to 240% increase in professional development time. And it's unlikely that you would go into any company and propose a 240% increase of anything. Although I understand the goal behind it, I think it's way too drastic of a change in 1 year. I did some research on the surrounding 9 towns, and I found that none of them use late start as a model for additional professional development. 11% use a full staff day, 33% have early release once a week, and 56% of them, so over half, use the model of early release once a month. So I would like the board to consider that as another option, more professional development time, but less often. A half day, 3-hour early release once a month as a compromise and a place to start. It's much easier for parents to problem solve a half day once a month than on a weekly basis. Working parents can take a half day off work. They can arrange sitters or play dates. It also gives teachers more dedicated time to learning new content, modeling and practicing, and some more supporting them for implementation. I know as a working professional, I'm significantly more productive learning something when I have a longer period of time to dive into the content, to practice and role play, and then work on implementation strategies. I think this is why it's very common in the workplace to have a half day meeting or even a full day offsite, and I think that can be the most productive time. In 60 to 90 minutes, you're just scratching the surface of any new content. And lastly, the once a month half day early release would still allow for 125% increase in professional development time over this year, which I feel is a much better place to start. Thank you.
am Dave Tate in Rockfield. I have a child at Blue Point and a child at Wentworth. First, I wanted to start with, well, first, I want to reiterate the points of the two people who spoke before me on the late start versus early release. I completely agree with that as a two family working parent situation. It's extremely difficult. I don't feel that in this description you've accurately done the challenges that you feel you have, but this one line for challenges on late starts is a little ridiculous and doesn't look like you've done any research into it. So, but the first question, before me asked the question, I didn't get her name, and I didn't hear an answer, and it was the biggest thing that's been bubbling around in my head. Why are we doing this death by a thousand cuts, little ones? How come? Is there a reason? I could not know, and that's why I'm asking you the question. I'm going to get time to answer. Why can't we do a deeper dive, early release, once a month? Is there contractual obligations? Is there what prevents us from doing that?
We're basically modeling this after the established practices of high-performing schools. What we know is that we are depending on our teachers to do more collaborative work. For example, the late starts that you have experienced this year, teachers have been working in professional learning teams, which is a form of basically doing research and dabbling into some instructional practices that will improve some targeted areas of student learning. What we know is that, for example, the full staff days are really not productive for us as teachers and educators. That what is much more productive and what research demonstrates to be more effective in terms of learning and actually making some positive changes within a school is time that is dedicated and it's regular and it is happening frequently. So it's not working for a full day.
So I didn't say a full day.
No,
it's like a half day, and it would be frequent as once a month. I think would be and it would be regular, which again would be once a month.
What
I'm hearing is that you need the time, and I get that. I completely understand that. I'm a parent. I'm a son of two teachers. But you're not telling me why it can't be. What's the difference between a longer one day a month versus every single week, 1 hour a day?
Research would say that more frequently is more effective. So once a month, yes, we appreciate that we get great work done. It's just that we're not getting the work done that we need to get done. So twice a month would be better. Three times a month, even better. Because it establishes a level of regularity that the teachers are working together. Smaller amounts are, an hour and 20 minutes or an hour and a half is not a deterrent for us. So it's probably more productive. It's more productive, more frequently happening for us.
I would argue that the disruption to my child every single week is far more disruptive to their education and my ability to get them to school and maintain a school schedule and their work life than it would be to have it once a month with a deeper dive. I'm not asking you to give up time. I'm asking you to reformat. And I feel like you've got all these redone proposals of it, and every single one is a lesser version of the same, just shuffling things around. And there's nothing that's drastically different. I would like to see the early release over the late start. I'd like to see the deeper dive. Other communities have done it without issue. And I'd also like to see going way outside the box. I mean, there's other options out there in terms of how communities deal with it that are far more drastic. I know we spent time in New Jersey. They have one less holiday during the school year, and there was a lot of stuff that happened there. I'm not asking that that's what we do, but I'm saying to say that you've exhausted your efforts and you've looked at all the ways to do it, and then just to have four proposals that are almost the same thing is ridiculous. And so if anyone has any rebuttal, that's fine. I'm good.
I think that, again, we based it on the late start model. It's the proposal. It's what's on the table. It's what we're vetting right now. We've put together the recommendation that we believe is most effective to moving our teachers and our students to where they need to be.
I'm living the Lake Star model. It's not working for me, and not working for almost anyone that's there with me in the morning, trying to get to work, trying to do meetings, trying to get my kids there, trying to travel. And if I could just have after school that other parent that was up, there's some more options. It's easier. I live in a community. It's easy for me to say, we're all getting off the bus. Can you watch the kids for 2 hours on their work day? I can't say, hey, I'm going to drop my kid off at your house before breakfast, maybe after breakfast. I'm not going to eat breakfast. Then I'm going to go to work. I mean, it's just, it doesn't work. And I got to tell work, I got a late start, and they think the school's flooded or something, because nobody understands why we're starting late. At work, my work day starts at 8 o'clock, and I have meetings, and that's just how it goes. It's easier for my work-life balance to do that. And also on the early release, I'm going to talk again, that I don't understand the middle of the week, because I know that when I was a kid and I was in school, by Friday after lunch, I was partially checked out anyway. And I feel like, why would you not capitalize on that and leverage that being the time? Is there a reason that Fridays are completely off limits and Wednesdays are better?
Okay. Just so you know, as we're responding to things, we're not advocating for late start or early release as board members. But you need to understand that's the administration's proposal. We're hearing from the public now, your opinions, and then we take all of that and we'll vote on it next week. The board has, we don't have a proposal. We don't have a horse in this game right now. It's our job to take all the information and to make a decision after we've heard all of the sides. But just as a point of information, Kennebunk does do late start every single week, and Bonnie Eagle also does late starts. They have, I think, 9. So we have all the information.
Westbrook does a thing too, but
early release.
Yeah. I don't know why Friday.
No, because early release on Friday in particular is a disaster for parents of older kids. They might not know it, but their kids are unsupervised for a really long time on a Friday afternoon. Scarborough used to have early release on Friday afternoons.
I know, I love it.
It's great for younger parents.
I came here and argued when we took it away.
I know, it's great for parents of younger kids, it really is, but you need to think about the middle school and high school kids. We're also trying to plan for those students as well, and it's a dangerous time. I mean, it honestly is. To have kids home from school at noon on a Friday, with no parents around for possibly 6 hours. So that was not ever, it wasn't a good situation. That's why it moved to Wednesdays. Even when it was early release, it went back to Wednesdays. Jackie, I think lots of
things. I just want to say, sir, we appreciate hearing you, and that's what we're here for. But we're not here to engage in debate. You ask a question, we'll try to answer it the best that we can. And we're listening to you, and we just hope you will listen to us. We have to deliberate next month. Appreciate your being here.
I will give up the microphone. I just wanted to make sure I got my point across. I mean, I'm here to debate it. I want to hear why. I want to hear why it's the way it is. So I don't understand your question. That said, let someone else talk.
Thank you.
To hold your applause. It's really not meaningful to us. We need to move on to the next person. I will also ask that you hold your comments to 3 minutes. And who's going to do? Mrs. Shea will clock that for us so that we can move on quickly.
I'd just like to make a comment about Wednesday. If you look at either late starts or early releases, you'll see that virtually all the districts have centered them on Wednesdays.
Why?
No,
that's not true.
That's the
answer. Why?
Because we have to follow a common calendar with schools that we work with. So we have
a reason to do it. That's all I wanted was the answer.
Yeah, that's why. We have to follow a common calendar.
But why do we have to follow a common calendar?
Because we send students to Portland Regional and Westbrook Regional, and all the contributing schools all have to follow the same calendar. So Wednesday is the day that all the districts that contribute students to those collaborative efforts, Wednesday is the day. If you have a late start or early release, if you look at all the calendars, it's Wednesdays at all the, in all the schools, right?
So if you have a comment you want to make or a suggestion or a question, please come to the microphone. Yes, next.
Hi, I'm Stacy Newman. I live at 17 Windsor Pines Drive. I have 3 kids, the oldest is in kindergarten at Blue Point, 2 rooms away. So a couple of things. I am also concerned with the fact, the woman mentioned previously that we are jumping in with this proposed, I think initially 32 days, 28 days. I think doing that without some time to see how this teaching program works is a waste of time. We don't know how productive that hour, 20 hour, 30 minutes will be. Maybe research shows in other districts for other schools that works. We don't know if it works for Scarborough. I think a much better use of our time, if we're going to even consider this, is to do it on a more tempered basis. I also agree with the suggestions that we have a longer half days. I hear the comments. I'm a working person, so I know that some long days of all-day development maybe are productive. But it does seem like maybe half days, less time, would be potentially equally as productive and less disruptive on the parents. As a parent who used to work full-time and now works part-time, I do appreciate that it is difficult, especially the late starts for working parents. And while there may be a benefit to teachers, a slight benefit, to doing early releases over the late starts, I don't think that's a benefit to the parents. And I think that's something that you should need to really consider. You have to do weigh pros and cons, and I agree that this list as it's laid out doesn't really reflect the con of the late start, particularly every week. Now, I have little children. Doesn't matter to me. They're up early. We take them out. This is what I think is best for the school. But I'll tell you, I'm also very concerned with something Dr. Erin also mentioned about the budget. He said the way this is proposed, it has no impact on the budget and no impact on the tax rate. But it has an impact on our kids, and it bothers me. Reading what you wrote about the need for this teacher training, you've sold me. I believe it. My little kids growing up in the system, I want the teachers to have this training. They clearly need it. Let's fund them. Let's fund that training. And I don't think as a starting point, I understand, I've been to all the school board fights all these years, the school board budget not passing, and the people being concerned with the budget. I'm always there fighting for our schools, and I know there's people on the other side. I also happen to be a lawyer, and I do a lot of negotiation, and I don't get this proposal. We need this, our kids need it, so let's start here at the bottom without funding it. I just don't get that. If you as a school board think this is important, I think that you do from what you've said, then let's fund it. Let's fund it. Let's start there. Let's start at funding it, whether that means more half days, whether that means you take out a holiday or something. Let's not start with cutting, you know, what's going to be 4 days of school for our children. I also work in special education law. 4 days can be a significant impact for a lot of our children. That's a lot of learning that they're missing. Thank you.
Thank you. Just one thing, I'm hoping that the principals will help me on this, but the amount of time the teachers would have during the late start, do the teachers start even earlier so that they have additional time? It's not just the time that the kids wouldn't be there. Does anyone want to respond to that? Anyone of the principals? I mean, I'm not sure how many more minutes it is.
I think maybe an average of a half an hour to 45 minutes more.
Okay, so
if they're at school.
So is it reasonable to say it would mean 2 hours of 2 hours of work for the staff together? Okay, that's what I wanted to know. Just wanted to clarify that. All right, thank you. Yes.
Yeah, my name is Barney Martin. I'm over at 17 Foxhole Drive. This is an old issue for me. I know I've been talking to you guys about this for a long time. When it started out to be, I don't know if it was 2, 3, or 4, then 1 to 7, 1 to 14. Every single year, it seems to be more increasing. And something that I've said, it's still true today, there's got to be a collaborative here with parents and the school systems. We're the ones that are trying to own homes here and live here and pay the taxes, that pay the public servants here and the teachers and everything. And if we're going to really be stretched to the breaking point, which this absolutely is for my house, I can tell you. I get up at 4 in the morning to support what I do here for my kids. I try to coach for them, I try to pick them up, I try to take them to all their various activities and whatnot. My wife is a director at a big company here. She cannot, we swapped it the days, but on these late start days, it's very difficult for her. And the mention that it was these buses coming in late, not only the kids hurting from that, but she's getting even later there. She's not getting home till late at 9 o'clock. So I just really like to see that collaborative. And I've never really seen it. So this is getting really pushed on us. I see a lot of gaps throughout the years. You know, the kids come home and they say they watch the movie for a period. That's not learning. When they're disrupted like this, they're not in school, they're not learning. Routine, boy, if you know kids, boy, routine is where it's at. This completely breaks that mold. I see tons of vacation going around. Why can't we? Do we have to get involved with the unions or something? Why do we need a February break right after we just had a 2-week Christmas break to go right into an April break? I mean, let's take one of those breaks out, put the week in the middle, and you've got a vacation between there and the end of the year. So I've never been in favor of this. I am completely in favor of the teachers here. I've had nothing but a great relationship with the absolute overwhelming majority of the teachers. I support them 100%. But there's got to be a better collaborative between the parents and the schools. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, good evening. My name is Paul Cozell. I live at 4 Lillian Way here in Scarborough. I have two children, a Blue Point student in the second grade, an eighth grade student in the middle school, and a student, the Wentworth student, and high school student. I like the other parents here tonight who are speaking in opposition to the additional release or late start days. Frankly, I've looked at this, I've thought about it a lot, and spewed a very bad idea. And I say that with one large caveat. I'm a huge supporter of professional development, as a lot of other people are here tonight. In my company, we encourage professional development at all levels, from our laborers to our crane operators to our professional engineers. We pay for this, and we do it for a number of reasons. One, we're required in a lot of instances for our professional engineers. Two, we do it to be competitive. Three, we do it because it's the right reason. We do it on a number of levels. We do periodic meetings. We also take a whole day where we shut our company down. And I can tell you, as a $40 million a year company, shutting the company down for a day comes with large costs. So I understand the cost component of this. Having said all of that, this is a bad idea. I would encourage the board to put this whole issue off for a year. And why I say that is that is when the teacher's contract comes up for new renewal and renegotiation. And then what I would do is to follow the lead of the prior speaker here, and I would encourage a collaboration at that point in time of not only parents and administration, but to bring the teachers into this as well. And I would say at that point in time, it would solve the problem. This break, every single day or every Wednesday of the year, I will tell you, is a huge disruption. Fortunately for my wife and I, we do not run into the problem of two working parents outside the home. We're able to handle the bus schedule. We're able to handle a lot of the other difficulties folks have. But I will tell you, on those late start days, it is a waste for our kids. I know when my son gets up in the morning with me anywhere from 4 to 5:30 in the morning, starting that much later, it's an unproductive day for him. For my daughter, it is the same thing. When we have these late start days, as I'm sure every other parent will tell you in this room, they know it's just not the same. It's a routine. I would kick this down the road for 1 year and collaborate. And at that point in time, I would come up with a better structured schedule. There's absolutely no reason that this can't be done on a monthly basis or even a less frequent schedule. We're all professionals, teachers, folks that work at my company, myself, and the other parents here. I find it very hard to believe on a less frequent schedule the benefits that the administration is pushing for couldn't be reaped in that type of situation. There would be ways of doing professional development before the school year, as well as after the school year. But let's get everybody involved. The way this is going now is a bad idea, and I do not support it.
Thank you. Next.
Hi, my name is Amy Chamberlain. I'm a mom here in town of triplets that are here at Fort Worth. And unfortunately, the last 3 years have been difficult for me, not just as a parent, but also as an educator myself. It's very difficult when you put yourself out there as an educator. I haven't taught in the system for a while here in Scarborough, but I will let all your parents know it's a wonderful school department. And the teachers do work very hard. I'd like to say thank you for everything that you do there for our children and for the community, because that is our family, our community. Just going through all of this and everything people have said here tonight, I'm in agreement with. I do have difficulty with the interruption in mid-week. As a past teacher, I understand how important it is for the teachers to make sure that we are staying well-informed, well-educated, and keeping up with the time so our students can meet those expectations of graduation. To be honest with you, I'm not going to say I'm worried about it right now because my kids are in third grade. I do worry about it for those students who are there, but it will all come. Scarborough does a wonderful job, let's not forget that. One of the things about the late start for me is, yes, it's very disruptive for children. We do know with many studies that children learn their best in the morning. We do know that when the children are going to school, we know some of our children have IEPs, you and mine do, which means they receive other services outside of the classroom. Those services, I feel, with this half morning, or late start, if that's how you'd like to call it, I feel will be very disruptive. By the time my children, your children, go in, snack, recess, lunch, learning, there's not a lot of time there. I know that as a teacher. It's going to be crunch. And that Wednesday, honestly, I don't want to say it this way because I support education, and I support the school board, and I support many of the faculty over there. But I find it as a waste when I was a teacher. I really wanted that time to get in and dig in and get it done. I know collaboratively, yes, but I don't find it as welcoming to do it that way. That's my personal opinion. Prime learning, we know, is in the morning, like I stated. The schedule interruption midweek, too much. I have a daughter with Asperger's. She's very high-functioning, very smart. But let me tell you mess up that Wednesday, Thursday and Friday will be hell in school for her. And behavioral-wise, you will throw off a lot of children who need to have that schedule. Whether they have special needs or not, we're all creatures of habit, all creatures of our routine. I just really, really want to state how important it is, and I think we really need to look at some other alternatives, not just for the teachers too, because I'd like it to be more effective for the teachers. But I really think I hear saying that when you discuss it and people ask you why you're doing this, you're always saying teachers first and then children. I want to hear children first, even as an educator, because that's what it's about, and I am a parent. And I am an educator, and I will be for the rest of my life. Whether I'm a stay-at-home mom, like I am now, I will help my community, and I will help those families in my neighborhood. But not everybody is going to be that lucky on every Wednesday of every morning. It doesn't really work that way. Our communities are not the way they used to be. They should be, but they're not. Thank you very much for supporting the town and the school and the children. But please, really, think of the children first.
Thank you. If there's anyone else in the audience who's planning to speak this evening, please go up and get in line so that we can include all of you. Thank you.
My name is Betsy Gleistein. I'm 14 Long Meadow Road. I have a daughter at Wentworth and a son at the high school. I thought I would originally be coming here to express my opinion about late start versus early release. As I carefully studied the plans, I became very concerned about both plans It's quite interesting to me that there are additional plans tonight. I studied the ones that were on the website. I would like to perhaps, if you give me a little extra time, PATHS, is Portland just changed their calendar because PATHS is starting September 8th. So our calendar isn't exactly in sync with PATHS. So that's confusing to me. But you made that comment, and I was looking at that. In a published paper that Dr. Entwistle did, he said, what we can likely all agree on is the fact that the world is changing. And I think there's some other things that perhaps we can agree on. I mean, I think one of them we can definitely agree on is we're all here because we care about our students, period. I think another thing that we can agree on is in public education, there have been a multitude of regulations, programs, changes to standards over the years. They've come with a host of names and acronyms, and we've seen various degrees of success and failure. We celebrate the successes with you, and fortunately, failing programs are mitigated over time. They're fixed with the help of dedicated teachers, with the help of the board, with the help of administrators, parents, and volunteers. But I don't believe it can be disputed that during times of transition and change, some students will be negatively impacted. As a system, we can fix our problems over time, but for individual students, they can never repeat their K-12 education again. That is why I urge the board to move cautiously with major changes that impact its instructional time and student changes. Both of the proposed school calendars that were on the web represented a major change, and as someone, I won't bore you with the math, but it's clear that I think we've all done the math at this point. As someone pointed out, it represented an increase of 215 to 220% time, and it was a total of about 6.5 days plus the 3 staff days of teacher development time, which, again, another thing I think we could all agree to is very important. I just personally think the risk to our individual students for that is too high. Even if you found a meaningful way to measure the impact, if the impact is negative and you decide to make adjustments, it will be too late for the students in the 2015-2016 school year. Changes like this need to be phased in and evaluated over time by a team of students, parents, teachers, administrators, board members, and the community at large in the context of the upcoming teacher contract negotiations. What is professional development worth to us? What do we want to spend? We need to do that, not try to get this all in one year. If you notice when we had the 2011-2012 calendar, our teachers actually lost professional development time when we went to late start. Now, you just said they come early, so maybe it all balances out. It wasn't a huge difference. It was 910 minutes versus 800 minutes. But if we want to do more shorter sessions, and you said the staff days aren't productive, perhaps we need to look at, you know, I don't know what you need the 3 staff days for. I trust that you need them, but you said they weren't productive. So I think, you know, we really have to be cautious here with how we do this, because my son is never going to get a senior year again. My daughter is never going to get a sixth grade year again. So, secondly, I'd like to urge the board, I know this was in the FAQ, but I would really like to urge the board to push back on the principals, the teachers, the administrators, to look for creative solutions during the school day. And it was a blanket statement that there is no solution. But I know of a middle school in Maine right now that is having very productive meetings, cross-functional meetings, every day of the week, by having all of their allied arts classes at the same time. And what that has allowed, they have grade-level allied arts classes at the same time. And what that's allowed the teachers to do is have a focused meeting each day of the week within a different group. On Mondays, they have integrated units, and they meet on grade-level issues. But I won't go into all the details. I'll just tell you they do a lot of the things that you're talking about by creatively changing the school schedule. Will it work for the high school? I don't know. But will it work in some of our schools? It might. And I would just challenge you to push back a little bit and say, let's look at this, how we can do this. Third, I would urge the board to balance these needs for professional development. And I'm another person up here to speak for early release versus late start. And my primary reason, I won't go into all the other reasons, but my primary reason is because of the wonderful extracurricular educational opportunities our students had, or at least a good number of our students had, for early release. There were cooking classes, art classes, music classes. There were martial arts classes. There were sports camps. And I can tell you, as a major proponent of the arts, I cherished those days that my child could go take art for 3 or 4 hours and come out covered in paint, whatever. So you just can't do that. The time is just not nearly as productive for the student, in addition to some of the other reasons. So I really appreciate your time. I'd just like to say in summary, I urge the board to return to the 2011-12 schedule with early releases, perhaps adding an early release or two, and that we step into this and we don't make this gigantic increase in 1 year. I also urge you, like someone else said, to start a community dialogue ASAP with students, teachers, administrators, board members, and the community at large, so we can set priorities and goals in this area specifically related to scheduling and all of these challenges that you're telling us are coming up, which we trust that you are absolutely correct on that. We need to incorporate these priorities in the next teacher contract. And finally, I would ask you, in summary, to push back, look creatively at the school days for collaboration opportunities for teachers across units, across grades, and across curriculum.
Okay, thank you. If I could have Mrs. Sizemore respond to the question about CADS.
Our school calendar is connected with Westbrook, Windham, Bonnie Eagle, and Scarborough. And we send our students to Westbrook. We also do send some students to Portland. But under state law, our collaborative is with the Westbrook. So those schools all have to have the same calendar. We also have to be 5 days. We can only have a total of 5 days that we're not in sync. So you might see a Wyndham, a Bonnie Eagle calendar. Their school day, their school calendar starts, I think, 2 days before us. But the important part is that the 5 schools, all the students start on the same day. So.
Right, she said past, and that's why I said that. I could just check past.
Yeah,
that's a good clarification.
Okay.
These are colleagues to put on.
You said something about dialogue and having people be present at a dialogue. We are having the third community dialogue since I've been here coming up, and that is happening on April 30th. It starts at 4:30, and it will be happening here in Wentworth. It's a great opportunity for people to come and bring. It's a there's not a pre-planned agenda. The agenda is whatever you bring that you want to discuss and what other people want to join with you to discuss. So it's a great open space forum. I want to address just another issue because you're absolutely correct. Some schools are able to much better embed professional development in the school day by using allied arts and those types of offsets. Let me just give you an example, and it's just a statistic that I find interesting. Our Scarborough High School was ranked number 10 in the state. So I was curious about that, and I wanted to use just a very simple metric. And a simple metric for those who know schools is how many kids are there for each teacher. So I looked at the other districts, the other high schools that were in the top 10. One of them was the Academy of Math and Science up in Limestone. They probably have a 1-to-4 ratio, or 1-to-6. So I took them out, they're averaging, and I looked at the average. The average of the other schools, the ratio was 1-to-11.75 kids. Scarborough High School is 1-to-15 kids. People say, well, you know, that's not a big deal. You know, it's like 12 to 15, I mean, it's pretty much the same. What that translates into is that if we had that same average at the high school up here, we would have 20 more faculty members in that school. So we have Scarborough has squeezed both in terms of faculty resources and also in terms of days that were allocated in the calendar. This is a drastic proposal. It's pushing the envelope. It's pushing the envelope to say, we can be doing so much more And for me, it is all about kids. It is fully centered on what is best in terms of advancing these kids. When I was hired by the board 4 years ago, I came from a couple of high-performing districts, and they said, what we want you to do is we want you to come in here, and we want this district to look like a Falmouth, to look like a Belmont, Massachusetts. And what I discovered is that we had whittled away on resources to the point where we got used to sort of this barely adequate level of having resources within these schools. This is a proposal that is basically saying, look, I don't expect the budget to be increased. In fact, we've cut way back in terms of what we're even asking for based on the history that I've been through with this team that I sit with. And we looked at it and said, what is the way that we can do this? And in our professional judgment, can we trade off some of that instructional time to improve the quality of instruction overall? We're implementing a brand new teacher evaluation system. It's focused on teacher growth, so it's heavily focused on teacher development. We're moving by leaps and bounds, and I look at the metrics and I can see the changes. And we are so close to really sort of kicking into high gear, but we neither have the resources. When we ask for resources, we end up getting a half of a new foreign language teacher for the middle school, when in fact there used to be three or more teachers there before all of the drastic cuts. We've not really even made it back to where things used to be. So I agree with you. If you look at Yarmouth, and look at Yarmouth's resources, the reason why they don't show a lot of things on the calendar is because they've got enough staff to really move things around and really embed a lot of that training into the school day. What that would cost us here would be amazing. 20 more faculty members at the high school would cost more than two, we would have a base budget of more than $2 million more than what we're working with right now. So it's really, it's trying to make the best with what we have and trying to advance what we're doing for our kids, recognizing that those resources are not likely to be coming pouring in. So I think it's a good, it was an astute and good comment in terms of that model, and there are certainly models out there that work like that.
Yes.
I'm Drew Stevens from 6th Surrey Lane. I've got one daughter in Blue Point and one in Wentworth. And to be honest with you, the late start is really difficult for the primary care kids, but for me personally, it's not as much of an issue when they're both in Wentworth, which is going to happen next year anyway. But I think for the other hundreds of people that have their kids in these primary schools, and for people that have issues with Wentworth, it's the mornings are difficult for everything that everyone's already mentioned, and they've been a lot more eloquent about it than I am, so I'll let that lie. You had mentioned, I'm sorry, I didn't get your name next to Mr. Entwistle, but you had mentioned something about Pawnee Eagle and Kennebunk doing, I think it was the late there when the late starts?
Kennebunk does late start every week, it was grade 6 as well.
But and everything, and pardon me if I'm just don't know about this, but everything I've heard at all the meetings, the only meetings I usually go to are where we fight every year about the school budgets and getting more money for you guys, which I think what I'm getting out of this is if you had more money, this wouldn't be an issue.
Correct.
So both. But also, whenever these discussions come up, everybody mentions, I think you just mentioned Falmouth. It's always Falmouth, Yarmouth, Falmouth, Yarmouth. I never hear anyone saying we're striving to be Kennebunk, Bonnie Eagle, or Westbrook. So,
we do say Kennebunk. No offense to Westbrook
and
Bonnie Eagle.
No, no offense to any of them. Yeah. I mean, still, I'm from Los Angeles, all the schools here. But it's the point is that I don't hear people striving for Bonnie Eagle. And so I don't know if we should be matching what they're. Does that make sense? It sounds like
it does. So I spent a long time looking at all of the calendars of surrounding schools.
Yeah.
Since the first proposal, we've spent a long time. The major difference between the school districts that have fully supported budgets and fully supported school districts and their budgets just pass and they put amazing things in and they happen, the difference is you don't see the disruption in the day for the professional development. It's happening. You just don't see it on the calendar. Parents don't see it. They see it in the results in the classroom, but they're not seeing it in their day. So Kennebunk has a unique model. They're 6 to 12 every week late start, and once a month early release K to 5. So that's a busing issue that they work out that, again, Scarborough's different, our geography's different, we don't have as many buses. It wouldn't work to do that the way they do, because they can shift their buses around in a way that we can't with 52 square miles. Yarmouth has, every week, teachers come in early one day, and they stay late another day. And the day they come in early, they're there before students, and then once students arrive, they have the resources to have allied arts. I would love it if we could have all our kids have allied arts at once. But if you think of, I'm most familiar with Blue Point, for example. We have one ed tech in the library, we have one phys ed teacher, we have one music teacher, and we have one
art. Part of an art.
That's four staff members that also need professional development, but that's four staff members. There's at a minimum of 12 classrooms that we need to have those. It just doesn't work mathematically. We don't have the extra staff that other districts have. That's the problem that has been created with year after year of squeezing and tightening and only a half teacher here, or we're going to cut this, cut that. I mean, this is what the result is. Honest to God, this would not be a problem if we had a budget that was supported in Scarborough every year. 100%, we wouldn't be here tonight. You wouldn't know when professional development was happening.
And it's a unique issue to Scarborough?
It's unique insofar as if you look at whose budgets have passed year after year,
yeah.
Scarborough has not.
I knew that part. I just didn't know about the other town.
Almost every other district.
They just walk in and pass them every year.
Pretty much.
About that, so.
And I'm not saying we need a blank check. That's not the point either. But, you know, even to
you're preaching to the choir.
I know. I mean, even to get to where Yarmouth is or Falmouth, I mean, we could never in 1, 2, even maybe 5 years reach that without huge millions of dollars additional in our budget every year. So it's a crisis, honestly. We're at a budget crisis, and it's creating problems that now you're seeing in your household, unfortunately. I'm sorry.
It doesn't look like it's going to resolve itself very well this year, because from what we're hearing from the state, we're going to be shy
$1 million.
We're short $1 million.
Off the top of what we have
last
year.
We will not be getting the kind of funding that years ago we used to. We're looking at huge cuts if changes aren't made, and if we don't have the support in the town. So, you know, we're trying to make little incremental increases towards improvement, both teaching and learning. That's what we're looking for, to try to make little incremental increases in how we teach and how kids learn. And now with the state mandates that have come down, we have no choice about it. We have to change the way things are done in a huge transformative way.
So why are we here?
So
sorry, all I'm hearing is no.
So
I mean,
I don't
get it. So just
to
listen to
this. Let's hear the rest of the people.
Yeah, okay. So we will continue to listen to you at this time, but you know, this funding situation is huge. Go ahead.
The funding situation stinks. I mean, it stinks for everybody and every family here that has to pay for childcare before school that didn't have to pay for it. It stinks for them too. But we all have to do the best we can with what we got. And I would love to fight for you guys to get more money. That would be wonderful if you didn't have to get your budget slashed. But we go through that every year later. We'll fight about that. The only other thing I would mention is just the young children, I think, what you say here, what you said tonight, I've never heard of young children that study better later in the day than early in the morning. And I've never heard that when they go to school, if they get out early, they spend the whole day lack of focused because they're excited about getting out early. Whereas I know, and you've heard many stories tonight, if they're getting to school late, and what you've heard about 1 hour late on the bus is a lie, because I sit there and my kid, I'm sitting there putting her on the bus. It is 1 hour and 25 minutes after the normal time, at least. Every single time consistently. So if someone's telling you it's 1 hour, that is incorrect information. Based on at least 3 years now, maybe more, of every single time we've had a late start.
So the focus in the afternoon. And I also think that the older kids, you mentioned something about the teenagers, when you're 14, 15, 16, I know you get in trouble, but you live in Scarborough. And I think we have a great community here, and I think a lot of these teenagers, they can do so much in the afternoon on their own that a 6-year-old, 7-year-old, 5-year-old, 8-year-old, they can't. They're barely old enough, some of them, to even go home on their own and open the door and go in the house. They certainly can't sit in the house alone for, you know, 2 hours, whatever, in the afternoon. But the older kids are there to help them out. When you reverse it around and do the morning start, and I know this was said already, but it's really crucial. A lot of us rely on these teenagers who are already old enough to watch these younger kids, even if they're not our siblings, our kids' siblings. There's kids in the neighborhoods that can do that. When they're already gone to school before the younger kids, it's not an option. That option's gone. So, again, I guess it's not as much for me personally, but for a lot of other people, I think it's much, much better to do the early release. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. My name is Michelle Orphan. I live at 9 Colbert Pond Road. I have 3 children, one at Wentworth and 2 in high school. And I, too, work in a neighboring school district where, to my knowledge, they are not proposing an increase in their early releases. We operate about once a month, early release days, and we have one full day. We also have an interesting schedule where they have worked by grade level to use the Allied Arts times to have grade level meetings. So no, they can't send every teacher's classroom to a special at that time, but they can send 3 grade levels in the classroom, or a team maybe at Wentworth could do the grade level to go to Allied Arts at the same time. And so I've seen that change this year in my building. I am strongly opposed to the cuts in instructional time. I get the professional development working in a school. I get the certification needs. I get the professional development and the professional growth cycle. I participate in them. Lots of it is on my own time. I get that. I cannot support this. There is no ounce in my being that can support cutting instructional time for our students. I feel so strongly. I have stood up here year after year supporting and thanking the school board and our staff and our administrators for the work they do. I get it. Our town does not fund our schools. Sadly, that's probably not going to change. But I just can't sit here and think that we will likely have a tax increase because of our school budget, not just because of our school budget, but we will likely have a tax increase. We're having a significant cut coming down. I can't look at anybody in the face and say, I support this tax increase and we're cutting instructional time. I just can't. It just goes against what I believe in for our students. And I know that this is needed. It is a bigger issue. And I know it's not something that can be solved. If this is needed, please be looking at a more cautious approach. This approach seems too severe. The cost is being put on our students because our taxpayers won't pay it, so now we're making our students pay it. So I ask you to take a more cautious approach. This is just too much all at once. Thank you.
My name is Maureen Bow. I have 3 students. I have 2 in middle school, 1 in high school. I find myself in uncharted waters here because, like Michelle, I have always been up here supporting. I have never been openly critical of what's going on at school, but this is the first time I stand here. I am so disappointed in this proposal. The fact that there is nothing on the docket except for this drastic increase in professional development at the expense of the students. And we can spin this any other way, that in the future it's going to benefit the students. My kids are here now. All the changes and cuts affected my kids. They're never getting this back. My son is going to college in 2 years. I have supported every increase. I have lobbied for every increase. And I have seen instructional time decrease, class size increase. So to sit here and say professional development is more important than instruction, which is what we're saying by making this choice, I'm so disappointed. This is drastic. We have no way to measure yet whether even the smaller increase would actually benefit the students, but it's not going to benefit the ones that are here right now. It just is. And I just cannot support this proposal. It's way too drastic. I'm really disappointed. I cannot lobby for this. I'm not sure I would support a tax increase at this point. In addition to these, this class time loss, we're not talking about all the insane amount of standardized testing that is being done and all the instructional time that is being lost then. However, if I had to live with this, and I don't want to live with this, I don't want my children missing any more instructional time in addition to the increase in class size, which reduces the quality of the education they're already getting, despite all the time I put in myself, despite all the additional money I have supported. But the late starts are horrible. The kids can't do anything with that time except sleep. When my daughter has such a huge workload, and make no mistake about it, when instructional time is lost, homework is increased. It's a fact. She can at least come home and get a jump on that. In the morning, we can have study groups at home when they have to work on group projects. No one's hosting a study group at 7 a.m., I can tell you. So that time could be better used to get their schoolwork done. So this may work for teachers, I don't know who it works for. Right smack in the middle of the week is terrible. If we're stuck with it because of other schools, that's unfortunate. But to do it in the morning and to expect to do it every single week is a huge loss to the kids that are here right now. And you'll excuse me if I'm not happy about the fact that in 5 years that might benefit somebody. Because I can tell you right now, my sixth grader isn't even getting the education that my kid in high school is getting. So what is it going to be like for her by the time she's in high school? So this is extreme. I encourage you, I beg you not to do this and not to support it. And I'm devastated that I'm actually up here speaking against the school for the first time ever. But this proposal is drastic. And I don't understand how we got this far without parents knowing about it or having any input up until now. And what's really concerning me is it's kind of like, this is just a small increment. This is not a small increment. It's a 200% increase and a significant loss of instructional time. It's not a small change. So I hope this doesn't pass, and I simply can't support it, and I think it's the first time ever I've had to speak. And I support my teachers, and they'd all tell you, go on to the mat for them. And I can support their development, but not at the expense of the kids. We have to stop supporting changes at the expense of the kids. This is supposed to be about the kids. So please help me pass this. Thank you.
Well, my name is Dave Dittmer. I live at 11 Woodside Drive. I have a daughter in Wentworth and a daughter in the middle school. And a lot has been said here, and I agree with much of what has been said. The main thing I'd like to say to you is that all these parents came out tonight, and I heard a comment earlier that the school board has not made a decision on this. This was put forth by the administration. Well, I'd like to ask the school board to recognize the fact that all these people came out here on a rainy night, or some of us have lost power most of the night. We're your base. And not one person here has said, really like the late start, let's go with the late start. We're the parents who actually do the lobbying for the schools. We're the parents who support and do those things that need to be done. So when the budget comes, we'll fill town hall and at least make enough comments that the counselors won't cut it completely. And the more support we get, the more support you get. Late starts are really disruptive. My daughters are both good students, and still Wednesdays are crazy. And you can't readjust from Wednesday. Thursday, it's like having a Saturday in the middle of the week, and you've got to readjust again and again and again. Every week would be too much. And the other thing I wanted to call attention to was that with the earlier thing with the high school bus schedule, you said that that would leave it written at a regular time. And if that's so, I believe there would be four bus runs that day instead of three, because on the days when they have late starts with the middle school, that would be going at a different time. So that would be a budget increase. And I don't know if you discussed that in the meetings, but that's just something that occurred to me when I was reading that. So, again, I think everyone has been very eloquent tonight, and I just wanted to say thank you for being here, and we'll see you again, hopefully, when it's time for the budget, and we can figure out then what we need to do. Thank you.
Thank you, and if there's anyone else in the audience wishing to speak, please get in line.
Hi, my name is Jennifer Lynch-Batch. I live on Shady Creek Lane, and I apologize if I have something formal, because I really came here tonight to just learn and understand some of what was going on. I have two children. They're not in public school yet, but my son will go to Blue Point next year for kindergarten, and I have a daughter at Little Cove Farm right now. And actually, this decision also impacts the preschool program that my children have attended the last 3 years. I'm fortunate enough to be a stay-at-home mom, so this decision does not impact me the way it impacts other folks that have spoken. However, it does still impact me in a number of ways, and I'm actually shocked that there aren't more people here tonight, because just in the past week since I learned about this meeting, which I appreciate you opening it up to the public, I have had so many conversations with parents that don't support the late start. So I'm just surprised there isn't a large audience here to hear explanations and to learn more, to voice opinions, etc. At least just to be present, so that you know that there's a concern out there.
Sure.
All of that said, I'm really here to educate myself on this. And so I have a couple of questions. One, I have probably two or three questions. One, I don't know if there is, and maybe my Scarborough leader, maybe tweet to get some information, but I don't, because I'm not involved in the school system yet. I don't know if there is a place to learn more about this proposal. I actually am surprised that, although I appreciate the FAQs that are provided tonight, and I've learned a great deal about some of the background of why this decision is being made. And actually, I want to back up for 1 second, sorry, I'm not more organized. But I have advanced education degrees. I fully support curriculum development. I appreciate your commitment to the education system. We chose Scarborough because of the school systems. I've only lived here 3 years. So I fully support the need for the teacher development. I've learned why you think it's better to have it more often, etc. But I guess I was surprised that the FAQs didn't address other alternatives, even though I've learned about different districts, etc. I guess I'd rather see Scarborough be a leader than a follower, though, of some of those other school systems and just be as creative as possible with some of the options. Now, I might be the group that's up here with these lofty ideas and lofty goals and whatnot, but I don't know. You know, I talk to these other parents, and we're like, oh, it would be great if it was a Friday, and once a month we could save on, I look at it as saving on bus route costs, and instead of having it just be delayed, let's just cut out a day of bus, transportation, et cetera. It does concern me in, that the Friday rationale might have to do with high school students and the situation that presents. But I don't know if other options have been considered, whether it's, I could be talking about something that is so unreasonable and unfathomable, I don't know. But I don't know if there's a way to have parents, volunteer parents in the classroom for an hour for primary classes to cover while the teachers have the development time, or if there are ways to have an activity in the gymnasium for students to be there with, a coach or someone. I don't know what the answer is. I just wish that there were other solutions that may be proposed than just these two. And maybe they've already considered. I don't stand in the shoes of the teachers and of the administration, so I don't know all of the pitfalls and the challenges, but I wish that there was more information about other alternatives than just these two, because I don't think that these are necessarily the solution. I don't support the late start, but I can hear the reasons why other things may not work. So one is just, one question that I have is just, is there a place that I can go for more information about other proposals that have been considered and have been ruled out? And two, I guess it ties into one, just what are the other options that have been out there and have been nixed? So it's really just, for me, it's about education, but I just feel like there should be more options or more discussion or more, something more.
more. So thank you, and I look forward to working with all of you in the future.
I think maybe just to quickly respond to your question, I think we've considered the options that we know of. We would not necessarily be able to move forward on a structural change that would be dependent on volunteers, because that just, I think you can see that that would be fraught with some issues. There are options in terms of full day staff days. We used to have seven of them. We now have three. Other districts do half days, which is a significant amount of time. So the kids come to school, but they have most of the day off. And that's fraught with some other issues in terms of people not really feeling that it's a legitimate school day, and so absences are pretty high. There is the late start that we've been doing, which can be controlled. Again, we're hearing about the bus issues. The late start is essentially accommodating not just 1 hour of professional time, but 1 hour and 20 minutes of professional time. So if the bus is an hour and 20 minutes late, it's consistent with the late start. And then there's an early release. An early release, again, happens generally after lunchtime. For working parents, one of the... sorry, I'm just getting over a little bit of a cold. For some parents, they find that to not be workable because there's several hours that a student is basically not supervised until, let's say, the end of their 5 o'clock work day. So that presents problems, and we're hearing today about people responding to the late start. The other piece that we were talking about in terms of resources is embedding the professional development within the school day, but in order to do that, you have to have more than just adequate resources.
And I understand that with the Friday, well, I understand there's a great time needing to work with other schools for the Wednesday versus Friday. I do struggle with thinking that, you know, just that limited time in the morning is enough time to really dig deep for the teachers. Just from my own corporate experience and whatnot, you know, when you have breakout sessions, discussion groups, or just any kind of discussion, I think it's such a limited time to really be able to make progress. And I understand, though, that you need it more frequent than once a month in order for them to make a conversation. I don't know I'm just kind of brainstorming as I'm sitting here, so I haven't done research or formalized anything, but even just being able to, if it didn't happen, say, the first and the last 2 months of the school season, and, you know, twice a month, you know, every other week you're getting a half a day or, you know, something. I feel like every week is a really interruptive, you know.
One of the proposals that is just being sort of put out there tonight, the copies of there, I don't know if it's on the website yet, but these other alternatives focus on the K-8 basically twice a month. So it increases the number of occurrences by 8, but it could be by 4. Or I think, again, it is pushing the envelope. It is not an unusual model, it's getting the right kind of conversation happening, and I think the people being aware of the need that we have. If you don't have the days built in, and you don't have enough staff, then in some ways you've got to find how to do an appropriate trade-off so that you're not giving up instructional time and not getting a good bang for the buck. Professional learning time that we have, which happens once a month, 10 times a year, the ones that people are having concerns about, support our professional learning team. And I can assure learning teams, and there's 60 or so of them throughout the district. It's collegial learning, it's inquiry-based, it's very data-focused, it's very student-improved learning-focused. So we have proven that even on a once-a-month basis, that short stint, it's very focused and facilitated as a trained facilitator in every one of those groups, can really make a difference for students. So
I think there's lots of conversations happening in the community, obviously, about this topic. I just think that the more education that they all have, too, about the decisions they made is helpful.
I'd also direct you to the article that's on the under news, and it's basically transforming teaching and learning, and I think that gives a lot of valuable background in terms of the kinds of things that happen during and that would happen during the time we're proposing.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Next,
yes, just to sort of piggyback on what she said about getting information out to the community. Please be sure to check our website regularly. We also do an email if you are interested in getting our emails on a regular basis. We don't send them out all that often. We don't want to bombard you with information, but we do send them out like once a quarter. Be sure to, you can email us and say, please add me to your email list. We're happy to do that. And we're also on Facebook to try to sort of keep information up to date and relevant if that's the case. Yes.
My name is Kathy Alto, and I live on the 15 Rocco Drive. I have one student here at Wentworth in fourth grade, and everyone who has presented a piece so eloquently, and I'm not sure that I have much to add as far as that goes, but I just did want to add my voice to say that I agree with everyone who has spoken before now. We are a two-parent working family, and I am exactly one of those people who has a family friend, high school student, who watches my son after school. And so my family is exactly that family who is burdened by a late start compared to an early release. In addition, in my particular case, which is probably unusual, but I just thought I'd mention it just to have it out there, I work a flex schedule, so I start earlier in the day, and I get out earlier so that I can spend more time with my son after school. And so this late start, basically, if I had to cover, that would be half my work day that I would have to take. And it really does not work well, whereas an early release works that much better for me in my particular case because I work a shorter day in any case. So I just wanted to give that as an example. The other thing that I wanted to mention quickly is that I also am concerned about the reduction in the instruction time, especially with the discussions that we've had about the number of teachers to students that we have right now. And my son is not a special needs, and I know that the special needs do get, you know, some extra one-on-one time, but our kids who are just in with the other kids, you know, they are rationed one-on-one time with their teachers already as it is. And I understand that these educational efforts will probably make the teaching time more productive, but I still think that there's going to be a need, especially in younger grades, for that one-on-one, okay, each student gets to read out loud a little bit for the teacher. Each student has a math question and needs a little bit of time. So these teaching efforts that are one-on-one time, I don't see how we can make those so efficient that we don't need them anymore. So I just wanted to say that there is that point about instructional time. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Brandon Atkinson. I live 30 in Pleasant Avenue, and I have three children under the age of six and under. My oldest is a student, first grade student at, what's his name? I'm going to keep it really short because I'm the last one. But basically, everyone's done a great job and brought up a lot of points that I wanted to speak about. And I think the first thing I want to say is that really the most positive thing I have to say is that I do like the late coming proposals more, where it seems clear that you've put thought into separating the older students from the younger students. With so many young people in my family, it's hard to really like reconcile our situation with, you know, the need of the older students. And like, while I understand that those needs are real, we have a certain other set of challenges that we're dealing with. I guess the other things I'd like to mention just are more like pertinent to how this whole process is felt in our family. I guess like one of the big things is that a few times it's been mentioned that this doesn't have any budget impact. And that's while I understand it's important from a negotiation standpoint with the town, this does have economic impacts for a family like mine. So this is a tax on me. Coming up with daycare, there's a lack of flexibility, means that, you know, this may be the straw that breaks the camel's back where my wife can't work, or you know, I can't take on the extra responsibility that gets me my pay increase. So just to try to keep that in mind where, like, we're all getting squeezed here. The economic situation is not the best that it could be, and all of these proposals feel disconnected from that reality to me. And I guess that's all I really have to say about this. Thanks.
Can you clap now?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Jamie Singh, and I live at Gateway Following. I have done a lot.
You were just repeating.
Oh, Jamie C. Hagan at Gateway Following. I have one daughter at Wentworth School. I have done a lot of research, talked to a lot of friends, other parents who are involved, who have done clearly more research than I already have. And listening to every parent, I definitely agree that jumping from what we currently are doing to once a week is drastically too much. I'm a single mom. I currently use Scarborough Community Services for childcare. So for me, I don't necessarily am not impacted by the late start or early release because my daughter is already currently here in the morning or after school. I can definitely see the benefits to both. Kim has brought up some great points about how 200% huge increase. I think maybe starting slow, starting small might be the better option. I looked at your second new proposal, option number three, where it's maybe twice a month. I think that's a little more reasonable, easier to manage, because I know a lot of parents are taking time off the work, are taking time to get their children here. And we as a community, it's hard to come together when it is 7 o'clock in the morning, or, you know, we just have to be there for one another. We have to get all parents involved, all teachers, all educators. I know for my daughter, she's expressed, there's been a lot of talk in our house, and there's been a lot of discussion. She's even expressed missing school, whether it's early release or late start. She enjoys being here in school, and she enjoys that educational time. And I think taking too much away from the kids, it can be devastating to them. As much as some of them complain about it, I really think they enjoy it, and I think it's great, and it's a good routine for them. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else in the audience who wishes to speak? Seeing none, I will close the public session. So, at this point in time, we're going to have an opportunity 7.0 for some closing board comments or discussion. If anyone wish to say anything? Mr. Piazza?
I would assume everybody's going to want to say something, so maybe we'll just start at the end and go down the line. First of all, I would like to commend everybody who has taken the time to come out here tonight and so eloquently express your opinions. It's very rare for us to get this kind of involvement. It always gives me encouragement to know that there are dedicated people in our community that really care about issues like this, so I appreciate everybody taking the time to do this. Your comments really are not going unnoticed, certainly on me, and I would imagine the rest of the board as well. We are all in this together. We know that you guys are our biggest supporters, and you're passionate about it, and that's why you're here. We respect your opinions, and we're very thankful that you're taking the time to come out and do this. As the finance person, I guess as chair for the finance, I don't want to beat a dead horse, so to speak, but it does all boil down to budgets. While it's been very clear these are proposals in front of us, we haven't made a decision yet. We don't necessarily want to say that one is going to impact the finances over the other, but we are in an unfortunate situation, and the consequences of years of reductions, and budget cuts. We're stretched, we're thin, We appreciate the support that we get from you, but we really do need more. We really can't continue to go through budget cycles of 2-3 failures before they pass. We put a lot of effort into realistic, I think, increases in proposals in our budget, and we really do rely on you guys to support us with not only with the council, but when it comes to the public vote as well. I had some questions, certainly for the administration, and those can come, I think, later. I just would like to make, maybe a comment, keep it short, I know it's late. I think Dr. Entwistle acknowledged that there really are three stakeholders here. There's the students, there's the faculty, and there are the parents. I think Dr. Entwistle and his leadership team have been very eloquent in presenting their need for time and their argument that this is very important. What I haven't seen yet, and I would like to see more of, is the interaction with the other two stakeholders. I think we need to have more sessions like this. I don't know if anything that we've seen so far is the end-all be-all. By definition, compromise is going to have to be, everybody's going to have to make some kind of decision and some kind of sacrifice in order to get something achieved, whether it's the administration or the parents or even the students. We're trying to leverage all of those. Obviously, the student needs are first and foremost in our minds, but we are limited with the impact that we can have, and I would like to see a lot more collaboration on developing, maybe some other options and other opportunities out there. So, again, thank you guys for coming out. I appreciate it, and the emails, I've seen them all. We may not respond to them. That's just kind of the nature of the mass email, but they are received. We do hear them. And I do appreciate the input.
Ms. Chen?
Yeah. I'm stuck going after a while, but I just want to say that, and I've talked to, as I look out here, I've seen a lot of familiar faces that I've had conversations with, and I think it's well known that my feeling is there needs to be a compromise. I think what Chris said is, everybody feels a little bit uncomfortable. There's the one end of the administration who needs this time, and I just have a hard time personally making that leap in 1 year. I think it's a lot to ask, and I think that there's a chance for us to sort of step back and use this as a bridge year and give some more time that's absolutely needed, but take this opportunity to figure out a bigger plan for this calendar. And we've talked about flipped calendars where high schools go later and younger kids go earlier because they're already out. I think this is an opportunity, and I think we need to sort of move cautiously in that if there's more coming down the pikes, we need to keep that in mind, make a little bit of a step forward this year in giving more time. Parents are going to have to understand that we're asking for a few more mornings or afternoons or however that flushes out, but take that next year and really develop a calendar that benefits all of the students. And this is our chance to do that. The leaders in that, Portland's looking at it, let's jump on board, let's really take the time.
First, I absolutely love seeing people here, because in 4 years that I've been on the board, it's really come at the begging of please come to budget meetings that we ever see people, and we've never gotten more emails than we have about this. We are absolutely listening to you. We absolutely always put kids first. Many of us have kids in the district right now and deal with the same thing. We have to rearrange some of our own school board meetings because of late starts. Everybody has to make adjustments, but I also want, like I said before, we have not decided anything. Honest to God, I changed my mind probably 4 times today about what is the best idea, what's the way to go with this. And that's real, because we spent hours this morning talking about it in a policy committee meeting. We are absolutely looking at every other school's calendar. We're looking at every single email. We're referring to you by name in your emails, because we're that involved in paying attention to what you're saying. It's all valid. It's all information we're taking in. We have received emails from people who love late starts. Nobody got up and said it today because I think they're afraid. There are some people here, I'm going to tell you, there are here that were for late starts. But no one is going to get up and say that, but they, for their family, that works. And everyone's going to have a different viewpoint on that, how old your kids are, if you both work, you know, what goes on in your house is going to be different for everyone. We have to take it all into account and decide what's the best for the Scarborough School Department, not just what's happening in everyone's individual house. And I get it that it's hard and it's messy, but the administration did what we asked them to do, to put together a calendar that has student needs first. And I know lack of instruction time, that is real, but the quality that comes out of increased professional development will pay off in dividends if we can get a calendar that is amenable to the most people. But the administration, that's their job, is to put together a plan that is the best case scenario, realizing the realities of the budget that we're in right now. We can't add $100,000 for a professional development day. We cannot. We can't buy new buses to make the Kennebunk model work, to have buses running simultaneously to get kids at different phase levels to school. We can't. So we are dealing with what we have. And so these options were the options that are zero cost to the school budget. We want involvement from parents all the time, not just about this. And I don't feel like we're doing anything ever in secret. Our meetings are on TV. They're online. They're public meetings. Even you could come to the policy committee meeting that we had today. You know, it's just, we're out there. We're trying to get people involved. In the 4 years, well, we've never gotten as many emails. We're losing $1 million from the state this year. This is a direct effect of that. That's what we need to be jumping up and down about, to get the money back in our budget so that we can have professional development happen outside the school day. These are all really real things that are happening in our district right now that we need to have engagement at all levels, including talking to your legislators, talking to your town councilors. I mean, it's an ongoing problem that seems to be getting worse by the year. Scarborough stands alone. I went to a regional meeting with school board members, and a lady from a different district came up and said, just making small talk, it was around when budgets were getting passed and everything. And she said, oh, where are you from? I said, Scarborough. She's like, oh, I don't want to offend you, but what the heck is going on with your budget every year? And I was like, I don't know. You know, like, we are putting together a budget that makes sense, that's student-centered, and we're not asking for the moon, but it keeps shrinking. So we're doing the best we can with what we've got, and we know that our budget shrinking has a direct effect in your pocketbook when you have to pay for childcare. It is not lost on any of us. We get it. We're trying to make a compromise that works for high school students, might not work for primary kids. We're trying to figure out what's the best that we can do with the buses that we have to get everyone to school for the most amount of time. So thank you absolutely for your emails and for coming and for speaking tonight, because no one's decided anything. We are trying to figure it out, and this is all part of the puzzle, so thank you.
Or any of that that was said prior to me, but I think compromise is going to be the key to this. Appreciate everybody coming out. This is a tough time for all of us as we sit here and go through all the issues, and you all go through all the issues. We understand many of us have students in school, many of us go through those same things. So thanks for coming out. Please keep in mind we did not make a decision. That's true, what's being said down there, so we're all still very much, as Kelly said, you know, changing our minds regularly, but I see compromise, and I hope that we can come to some kind of agreement that makes all of us slightly unhappy and slightly happy. So.
Okay. There was something. I have to be honest that I did not, I couldn't support the proposal, at least for as long, because my concern is the reduction in instructional time. And I feel no matter how you say that's going to improve, just like some of people said, that 1 year damage reduction is going to be hurt the kids in school right now, and any proposed bills that, you know, revenue users, the program revenue that PLT should take it at a certain, you know, very cautiously and consider the risk that that not a program that's successful and not a program not successful. So, with that said, you know, I want to hear that we as board cannot, that's my understanding, we had our discussion with policy today, cannot bring up a proposal. So we have to look at what's the administration bring up to us and will not. So I hope the leadership is going to consider everything everybody said and maybe compromise, give everybody something like source reorder, not only the parents, the students, and you know, we do have a compromise. But the thing is, you know, we have to just vote on whatever that comes to us. And from my understanding is, if nothing goes through, you know, we have to stay with the status quo. That means what's not your candidate. So everything, you know, I think we are definitely listening. I mean, I see so many faces, and I know people who involved in supporting schools, and I really appreciate you being here. I know you are going to be here for the budget, and I really think we need to support the parents and the students to do that. So that's my comment today.
Thank you. I wish to support all the thank yous to you being here that have been brought up by my colleagues. And I hope that you will keep the emails coming. Perhaps you've gotten different new thoughts this evening that you can communicate to us. And I want to thank Mrs. Beely, our chair. She has answered every single email that has come to the board. And she did it while she was on vacation. So I really think that's yeoman work on her part. And I personally appreciate it. I also think that several of you mentioned the teacher's contract. And I have been on negotiations for a lot of years. And I can tell you this, that every time we have added time or had to take away time from the teacher's school year, the teachers have been amenable to that. When we added 5 days a few years ago, we paid them. And then they said to us, use the time any way you wish. That was in negotiations. We had to remove, because of budget cuts, we had to take back 2 of those days. And that reduced their per diem. And they said, well, we understand. Use the time left any way you can. So what I'm trying to let you know is that our teachers have been extremely supportive of how we use this time to benefit our children. And there's never, ever been debate about it at the negotiations table. Every time I vote, my first thought is, how does this affect our children? And I will do the same thing when this comes for a vote next week. It is not easy. I was a teacher. I know how important this is. I know what is coming down from the state on the mandates, what our administrators and teachers are having to go through, and that we have to prepare them as well as our students. 2 of the things that directly affect your students that our teachers have to become well aware of is the proficiency-based diploma, which is starting in our elementary schools. Children are going to have to show and demonstrate proficiency. State is requiring the testing be done on computers. Well, even our high school doesn't have one-to-one computers. So These are just two of the things that our teachers have to become prepared for in the future. And everybody mentioned the $1 million reduction, but they haven't mentioned to you that at the present time, the reduction to the town on revenue sharing is over $800,000. So, you know, we have some serious challenges here, and your support has always been important. It's appreciated. You being here tonight is very appreciated. Keep those emails coming. Keep the support coming. We can agree to disagree on some things, but we all want the best for our children. We can agree on that. So again, I haven't made a decision, but you can bet it will be in favor of our students.
Thank you. So pretty much you've heard it, you know, from my colleagues here. You know, we really care about what's happening with our kids. We want to listen to our administrators and want to hear what they feel they need. And we want to listen to our parents to hear, you know, what your wishes are, what your concerns are. But honestly, we almost never see parents ever at any meetings. I've been on the board just 2.5 years now. I can recall one other night when there was a group of parents here. Otherwise, we just hope and beg that you'll go to the polls. Because this issue here is going to resolve in another week or two. We'll have a resolution. The bigger issue is going to be the budget. Once again this year, and it's going to be a major issue, I can tell you. We can see it coming. And we need you to pay attention. Pay attention. If you can't come to a meeting, look it up online, or you know, make sure you're looking at the Facebook page we established, or any articles that we print in the newspaper, so that you know you're ready and aware of what's happening in our town, because we really need you to care about education here. It's completely essential to have you on board. So with that, if there's no other comments from anyone?
I have a question.
Okay. Yes?
Can you just clarify exactly what proposals will be voted on by the board for next week?
The Leadership Council submitted proposal number one. The board and I created proposal number two, option number two, I guess it's called, which was looking at about the same amount of time, only in an early release model. The new ones that you're seeing were just that differentiate between K-8 and the high school are just other options that were generated. They are indeed all late starts. But they just looked at some, as people have used the word, some less drastic options. I suspect that the board will be asking me to generate, me and the team, to generate other proposals. But whatever will be voted on I will be part of the school board package for next Thursday. If anything gets developed, we'll get it up online just as quickly as we can. So, you know, it's the will of the board to ask the superintendent to draft a couple of other options if that's what they wish to have you do.
Thank you.
Yes?
Just on that same thing, when that vote does happen, that's public, right? We'll be able to see that vote.
Yes, so all our
policies. Mm-hmm.
And for point, if it is on the agenda, the public is able to speak as well.
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
That's correct. Just so
yes.
They know.
I have a question based on what Ms. Lynn said. So you're, as board members, not allowed to bring forth proposals. The proposals have to come from the administration?
Yes, when it comes to the school calendar, the school system develops it, brings it forward to the board. That's accurate.
So is that tradition, or that's mandated by policy, or?
Okay. Policy, yeah.
We bring it first. My team and I bring a first reading to the board. That starts the conversation. This has been sort of a 3-week, it's going to go another The vote is next week, so it's been going on for maybe 4 weeks or so. I think that we make our proposal, but it was board members and myself that did the flip proposal, which was the early releases. The other couple of alternatives were based on what the board asked for, and I suspect that they'll be asking to look at a couple of other options. So while we start the process, the board will ask the superintendent to provide, you know, give us an option for that's like what you're doing for K-8 in version number 2, but make it early releases instead, or whatever.
There's a chance that we'll table it next week. I mean, if there's a lot of different proposals, or are you just going to do all that by email based on, because it just seems like this public hearing is a little late in the process, because if you'd heard from us maybe 3 weeks ago, you might have asked for different proposals. So, you know, or maybe you would have done a survey, a numbered survey out to parents that my number is 33456, and I give you that survey back. I prefer late start to early release so that you had a concrete number. And if you guys knew that 20% were for, or 10% were for late start and 90% were for early release, I'm assuming that would impact your decision of what you did, because, you know, regardless of how you feel about it, at some point the public will kind of play in. So, you know, it just seems very kind of late to be hearing from the public at the public hearing. That's just my opinion.
I tried to come last week.
Mrs. Sizemore, do you want to inform about something?
Yes, before we even start on the calendar, we work with those other school districts, and we are committed in the calendar this year for a staff day on October 9th, and that is a regional one. And also, when you look at the holiday schedule, we're committed to those, right, and to the Wednesday being the day. We have to submit this calendar along with the other four districts to the state for approval, and that we have worked together to come up with a common calendar for those voters.
Okay, any other board comments this time?
Question? Joyce Heisman, what is the deadline for that? Do you have to get that into the state?
It's already been done.
The committee, we can say early release, late start. We have flexibility with that.
Yeah.
We can say, you know, we have 5 days that we have to be in sync. So, for instance, on May 27th, that is a day that is out of sync with the other districts, because we believe that our PLT day, our day of sharing, is important. The other districts pick March 25th. So that's one day that we're already out of sync. Bon Eagle, they're starting their teacher day the week before. That's okay because the kids aren't there. But we're committed to start full student day will be September 2nd. That's when all the kids will go to those low schools 10 to 10 and it doesn't be trouble.
Yes. I saw a comment on the budget. I read with horror after the last budget vote that there were people that voted against the budget because they thought it was too low. And
yes,
I don't know the mechanism for getting the word out. I mean, as parents that are here, we obviously are fairly aware of what's going on. But there are people that don't have kids in school that we need to vote for that budget, and they're not getting the word the way they need to get it.
There's 15,000 voters in this town. 3,000 usually vote on the school budget. 3,000 or less vote on the school budget.
Can I comment from the financial standpoint? I don't know if you're all, most of you probably are painfully aware of the process. We develop a budget, we come up with the numbers that we think is the best interest of the district, we try and balance the tax implications and things like that. We present it to the council, the town council. The town council has the ultimate authority to set that number whatever they want. I've never seen a budget get rejected the first time and get increased the second time around. Okay, so just so you guys are all aware, regardless of the budget that we put out, it's well thought out. It takes a long time to develop that. Ultimately, the town council has the say in what that number that goes out to the public is. So, you know, I hate to say this, but you're actually preaching to the choir when it comes to developing the budget and making sure that the numbers are there. We really need to work on focusing our attention and our efforts in areas that are not impacting us in a positive way.
And the initial rollout of that budget will come next Wednesday?
April 1st, Wednesday.
Wednesday, April 1st.
It's not an April Fool's
joke. But just to answer your question about the too low thing, people vote. So that's a question on the ballot. Too high, just right, or too low. That's non-binding. That's an opinion question. And there's absolutely, makes me crazy, there's no mechanism. They don't count the ballots in a way that you can see that somebody voted no, too low. They do two separate tallies. So even if people are saying no, and we have a lot of too lows, unless the too lows overtake the too highs, I mean, that's the way it is. That's the way they count them. It's frustrating. I'll leave it at that.
And so Mrs. Lane, you want to make
yes, I have one. Go back to the campaign. There was one issue I think nobody had mentioned is the Portland district is looking at a later start for the high school. I think I don't think it's included big school. So and research shows that it's better for middle and high school students to go to school a little later, like after 8:30. So it's so the needs of earlier, you know, 8 to 5 to 6 to 12. Is very much different. So we try probably going to keep those things all in mind, and also you guys keep that in mind too. It's actually better for the early kids to go to school later. And probably the best way is every day we start later. So of course that's you see that might be some problems for some working families, but that's what's good for the kids. So it's there are lots of different places that are doing that. So certainly, we have to keep those things in consideration.
Can I ask, what is being proposed? Is it 20? Is it every single Wednesday and some kind of flavor of late start, early release, or is the number of these Wednesdays still on the table and part of a compromise collaborative? Is that yes or no?
Yes. Everything's on the table. Everything's
except
on the table. Except the day. That's the only thing that is non-movable.
Except what?
The day of the week.
Wednesday.
The Wednesday.
It will be Wednesday.
Yeah.
Early release, late start, how many? None at all? All on the table.
And I just want to point, we're limited with the vocational requirements that we have, but we're not fixed by them. We have some latitude. It's very little latitude, but we do have some latitude to work within those parameters. We're allowed a certain number of days out of compliance, so it doesn't have to be exactly spot on, but we can't go completely off the ranch, so to speak, and come up with something completely radical, because then we wouldn't be in compliance with state requirements.
Well, did I hear there were 5 required days?
No, only 5 non-conforming days.
Right.
So how many required sink days are
there? So we have 177 school days. So 172.
How many sink days?
Of the whole calendar, of the whole year, we have 172 have to match with other districts. We're only allowed 5 that deviate.
Basically, it means if we want to take a teacher day, let's say on October 8th, staff day on October 8th, the rest of the communities may have that as a regular day, and they'll send students to Westbrook. Our students won't go that day, so that's a non-compliance day.
Okay.
So we have some flexibility within that, those confines. We're not completely boxed in, but it's fairly that we've got that. Plus, we've got minimum state requirements for the number of days the kids have to be instructed. And then we have contractual obligations with the number of total teacher days that we can have. So it's they're kind of, if you think about overlapping concentric circles, the really space we've got to work in is a pretty small window. With all of the different things to work with, but we're not fixed and obligated to mimic exactly the Westbrook regional calendar. Does that make sense?
10 to 60 vocational students that were one component that we're raising around of the 1,000 or 3,000 kids.
Yeah, but the challenge with that is it's a state obligation. So whether it's 2 kids or 20 kids or 60 kids, we're obligated by law to conform to that requirement. So, again, that's something that we don't have control over, and it's...
Let's get Hudson Rocky, Indy Loke, and get them all out there and get a change.
we just set with all of our representatives 2 weeks ago,
hours-long meeting.
We spent a lot of time telling them what our issues are and explaining to them what we need from them.
I think it's also...
So we do that, and we also lobby in the state. We go up to the state and complain ourselves personally on some of these issues. So to say we're not doing it...
Here's the bottom line.
You guys are growing the standardized testing now.
Okay. To me, here's the bottom line. Here's the bottom line. We advocate as best we can from where we're sitting. That's on you guys to really motivate the representatives to get your point and your ideas across them. We all, that's part of our requirement. I spend hours and days up in Augusta lobbying for money. The $1 million we're losing in the EPS formula is the largest of any community in Maine, okay? So we all feel it. We've had special meetings outside of the general public with our representatives to try and find a resolution to it. So, but we can only do so much. You all have to be the proactive ones to get that groundswell going and say, this isn't right, we don't like this, and exactly what you're doing tonight, you need to do it in Augusta, and you need to do it in front of the right people.
Okay, I don't want to get too far off of the topic tonight, which is the calendar.
Okay, I actually just had a follow-up question. You were saying before something's happening on April 1st?
It's the rollout of the first reading, so in other words, it's the introduction to the town council and to the school board of the school budget and the town budget.
And that is it's an open meeting that you can all be at?
You can. It's basically just a presentation, probably not very long, but it's the beginning of the conversation of the budget.
Do you need us there for that?
Pardon?
Do you need us there for that?
Does that help you to influence the town council to give us more money for the schools? Because we always feel like we're showing up last minute at the voting time, which is wonderful that everyone shows up, but it doesn't sound like that's the fact.
This would be showing up at the first minute, because it's the very first time that we're exposing the budget. A level of interest by parents is always noticed.
And the town council opens that up for comments from the
I'd also like to point out where I don't know if I can share this quite yet, but I guess I'm going to do it anyway. We're exploring the option of having a quote-unquote budget forum between the two finance committees. It's not finalized yet, so I don't want to give out too many details, but that will be potentially another opportunity for everybody to come in a similar format to this, ask questions, interact. The goal is to have both school and municipal there. I don't want to share too much because we haven't officially finalized that yet, but we are discussing that in our joint finance committee meetings. So that's an area where you could have a big impact for sure. And active participation on any level is welcome because, you know, the comments before of us not seeing too many people, we can interpret that two ways. We can interpret that as we're doing our job well and nobody's really concerned at what's going on, or nobody's really engaged and nobody's aware of what's going on. So the more you can participate, everybody's stretched. We are too. I get it. We don't ask you to be at everything. Get on the email list. Get to the Facebook pages. We'll try and do our best to communicate the critical meeting dates when you can best maybe optimize your time. But certainly you're welcome to any meeting of any committee at any time, both town and school. Everything's wide open.
How do you get on the email list?
Just leave the email.
Is that something you can do? You know, this meeting is a critical meeting. You know, is that something you can say this town council meeting is a critical meeting? You know, it sounds like next week there's an April 1st meeting for town council, and also voting on this the next day, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, that'll be tough next week, but okay. But, you know, so if you can do that, that would be really helpful. I can't, you know, go to every school board meeting and every town council meeting, but for critical ones, I'll go to them. So that would be great. This is really important.
This is red.
Well, we can't use that.
We apparently are locked into this Wednesday thing because other schools chose Wednesday. Does anyone know why they chose Wednesday? Because it seriously is the most disruptive day of the week.
I don't know.
Like, do not take a Monday or a Friday.
Monday is holiday, right? You don't want to touch the holidays. I get that, sure.
Friday doesn't make any sense. For people that go to school, but it's on the weekend, they go to teaching.
all think Wednesday, and it's a good reason. That might sway me. There was actually a good logical reason for choosing the center of the business.
Over the years, they found that Wednesday had less absenteeism.
Absenteeism from what?
From
school.
Came to school on Wednesday compared to on Friday.
Well, then it would be less disruptive.
And then they also
Less kids would be disrupted on that.
We also felt that students felt that they had time to work on projects during that time and their homework to get caught up for the next part of the week, Thursday, Friday, if they had a test.
Any other comments from the board? We are set. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All in favor? 7. Thank you.